for this opportunity. I think we are going to discuss in this session very, very common issues, which are so common that they are often not well understood. Cough is just one of them. I'm sure when a child comes with a cough, you are really very, very sure that nothing will put that cough all right, irrespective of your diagnosis. He will keep on coughing till the nature decides when to stop it. And the parents expect us to do something very concrete. Then there are many who keep on coming again and again and wondering, and we have offered no answer. And when there is a definite answer, they don't cough much. They always don't cough much. TB cough is not an issue. And therefore, funnily, those who cough, we have no easy answer. And whenever we have an easy answer in pulmonology, they don't cough much. And I think with this this kind of a situation, we are left with how basic of any clinical medicine is to exactly first define the anatomy of the disease. And I think not only just the anatomy, but the microanatomy. Which part of the respiratory system? You know that cough can come out of a cardiac disease, a respiratory disease, maybe a neurological disease, so on and so forth. Once you know it's probably a pulmonary disease, we need to know very clearly whether it's an airway disease. And if it's an airway disease, is it really an upper or a lower airway? If it is a lower airway, there could be a lower small airway and a lower large airway. And then, of course, there's a lung parenchyma, there's a pleura, there's an interstitium. I think at each level of this microanatomy, you are very clear what kind of cough this child is producing. And unless you have a microanatomical diagnosis, you're not sure what next you should be doing. And we know very much that when there is an airway affection, there is a significant cough. So anybody who coughs badly has an airway disease and not a lung parenchyma disease. And to that extent, I think we need to be very clear that more the child coughs, lesser would be the need of a chest x-ray. Because chest x-ray doesn't show airway much. And almost certainly, there would be less need for an antibiotic because bacterial infections are localized in the respiratory tract, often in a lung parenchyma and not in the airway. And I think even if we take away this whole message that more you cough, lesser the x-ray chest, and lesser the need of an antibiotic. Then I think we have done mostly very good. But you would ask me then, what do we do? That's the only thing we do. We need to microanatomically localize before we decide what it is. And upper airway, for example, could be a bacterial infection, like we know, pharyngitis, etc. That's one area, but you can see almost clinically the pharynx, tonsils, etc. When it comes to the lower large airway, the cough is more than tachypnea. You know, bronchitis has far more cough than tachypnea. But you come down on a lower small airway, a tachypnea becomes more than a cough. An acute bronchiolitis has more tachypnea than a cough, and an acute bronchitis of any kind has far more cough than tachypnea. So again, trying to see which is the predominant symptom, you almost come to know where you are. But when it's a lung parenchyma, the cough is not a predominant feature. Here is a child of pneumonia where the parents come with fever, tachypnea, and you ask them, what about cough? They said, yes, a little cough too. In fact, when the pneumonia starts resolving, you have a cough increasing, but not at the onset. And therefore, I think it's important to get to that. Pleura, of course, we know has a chest pain. But what's more important between the lung parenchyma and a pleura is the distribution of signs. You have a lobar distribution of signs. What does that mean? And right upper lobe, all signs are anteriorly in the upper half. And right middle lobe, all signs are anteriorly in the lower half. And all signs of lower lobe consolidation are posteriorly. Whereas if it's a pleural distribution, it's all over. And I think that differentiates. Otherwise, bronchial breathing or whatever, it's just same for all. A collapse, consolidation, cavity, pleural effusion, all cause the same signs, but the distribution of signs are different. And when it comes to interstitium, it's the lowermost part, as if of the airway. And when the interstitium gets swollen up, it compresses the lowermost airway. And therefore, it behaves like a very slowly coming up tachypnea, or an acute onset of interstitial pneumonia. What is further clear is airway diseases are bilateral mostly, barring an inhaled foreign body, for example. And an interstitial disease are also bilateral. And a lung parenchymal and pleural diseases are not bilateral. I think even if we just go by this, you know where we really stand on this. And I think unless we know the microanatomy, we should not further talk about that. Let's look at simple cough rules. If a cough is a predominant symptom of a situation, for example, you have a child with fever, cold, cough, and we look at the cases and exactly apply these rules. And the point that I'm making is that if we simply apply rules, you almost come to a diagnosis by history itself. The clinical examination supports, and if required, the investigations confirm. But what is the rule of an acute onset cough? A predominant symptom. Whenever a child has a fever, cold, cough, whatever, we need to know what's the chief complaint. And if the chief complaint and a predominant symptom is cough, then you look at, is it with fever or without fever? If it's with fever, it's either a viral or a bacterial upper respiratory. Bacterial is rarely lower respiratory with a significant cough. And if it's an upper respiratory, you are able to see it easily. And again, there is no hurry to diagnose a streptococcal pharyngitis on day one. Viral and bacterial may look alike unless you have a definite submandibular glands tender. But without that, there is no hurry because we know that there is no risk of a rheumatic fever if you delay a correct diagnosis of a streptococcal pharyngitis. And most of the viral infection, we know, as a rule, start with high fever. And then in between fever, the children are very fine. And then by day 3, day 4, most of them are all right. And they have a generalized symptoms and signs. All viral respiratory infections have a congested eyes, a running nose, a congested throat, a bad cough, whereas the bacterial infections are localized. So it's easy. 99% this rule will hold true. And if you miss 1%, you will know in the next 2 days. And if you don't follow the rule, it's 50-50 whether you are right or wrong. And if it's without fever, then a simple thing again, is it atopic or non-atopic? We know personal history of atopy, family history of atopy. That becomes some kind of an asthma, otherwise it's a hyperreactive airway. And we know that there are many kinds of hyperreactive airway, especially in the small child. And I think this will almost cover near 99% of all causes of cough, when the cough is a predominant symptom, with fever or without fever. And I think you make a clinical diagnosis just by the history itself. What about the cough rules when it is chronic? Now, chronic could be persistent or recurrent, and it's not easy to differentiate the two anyway. And there's no need to do that either most of the time. I think every disease which is persistent may not have a persistent symptoms. Symptoms may wane off and on, but the disease is persistent. Therefore, a child of tuberculosis, for example, who comes with fever, cough off and on, the fever cough may be off and on, but the disease is not off and on. Therefore, the disease is picked up by what is happening in between. And what is happening in between is, child is not behaving well, he is lethargic, he is not eating well, he doesn't play well. The mother knows that his behavior is changed. I don't think doctor is all right. Of course, he may be losing weight, losing appetite, whatnot. And the fever cough may be off and on. So, persistent disease is also the recurrent symptoms of a persistent disease. And a persistent disease is picked up by the behavior abnormalities. And to that extent, again, with fever or no fever? With fever, viral, significant. We already know how to differentiate viral from bacterial. And this is so common once the baby starts getting into the community. And the bacterial, the most important part is that if ever you wrote an antibiotic within a short period of time, for the same illness, which means this is a recurrent bacterial infection in your mind, I think you need to demonstrate the background cause. The message is clear. Recurrent bacterial infections have a background cause. Recurrent viral infections have no background cause and are innocuous and need only reassurance. If it's a recurrent upper respiratory bacterial infection, we know adenoid, tonsils, sinuses, they're all causes of recurrent bacterial infection. And unless you document probable cause and react to that, you will not get better, and each few weeks discharge will come again and again. And of course, if it's a lower respiratory bacterial infection, almost always it's something serious background disease, like maybe a CF or an immotile cilia or an immune deficiency and whatnot. Even if we know surely that no child should get antibiotic within a short period of time for the similar infection again, I think then we are okay. And of course, viral infection do not need an antibiotic. However, if it's an episodic thing, then we already talked the same thing. Majority of them have a recurrent problem, and we know how to differentiate the visors, and all of us are aware of this. This comes very handy to even explain the parents what it is. Most of the time you will see a child around 2 years of age who has a recurrent cough. Many times you might not pick up a wheeze, and you will have to decide whether this child is likely to be having a wheeze. Many of them have nocturnal and of course episodic. So when you see them, they have no wheeze, often they have no cough. You need to kind of get the wheeze out by a deep inhalation and exhalation, which may not be possible in a small child. And therefore you will have to go by the story of what looks like a hyperreactive airway or an atopic. And what is allergic in clinical medicine? What happens suddenly, what disappears suddenly, and what keeps on recurring is allergy. So anything that appears suddenly, disappears suddenly, and recurs is called allergy. And if that is the story without fever, often nocturnal, often exercise induced, I know even if I see a child in the morning without a cough and without a wheeze, I anticipate that this child probably has a wheezing disorder. Of course, younger the child, he comes with a wheeze. Because the airways are so small, they wheeze even for nothing. And as the child gets bigger, the wheezing is not easy to pick up, and you need to make efforts to understand that there could be a wheeze. But here is a child at 2 years of age, where we know he is wheezing. He could be a transient wheezer, the first kind. Not uncommon at all. He has a reason to wheeze. He has a smaller airways. He has an immature airways. He was born small. He was preterm, IUGR. He had some kind of an aspiration at birth, a meconium aspiration maybe, or he had some early respiratory problem, and that will keep him wheezing through the first year or even two. And he will get well over time. He needs just a reassurance. And he needs to be told that, yes, you will wheeze again and again, but your life is not in danger. You just treat him symptomatically and he will be all right. But at the same time, at about 2 years, there is another fellow who is a non-atopic wheezer. He may often not start right at birth, but a little later. And he's getting triggered by commonly a viral infection, like typically a Valerie. He gets fever, and then next day he starts coughing and then he's wheezing. The fever disappears quickly, but the cough and wheeze continues for a week or two. He may have a background cause of even a so-called family history of atopy, but he's getting every time triggered by fever. A typical asthma does not need fever to trigger him. Now there is always an issue whether this is a fever triggered asthma, like you have a fever triggered epilepsy. Yes, but commonly no. And therefore you would see this as a typical one that may go on even for 4, 5, 6 years of age. There is not a clear mandate whether this child should be given an inhaled steroids. But yes, there are some authors who would say inhaled steroids would work on this, because there is probably a combination of an atopic predisposition on the top of which you get a viral infection and get triggered. All the same, the first transient wheeze does not need inhaled steroid. And a third one, typically an asthma. If you see this curve, you know the trend. The transient wheeze, by the time he's a year, year and a half, is demonstrating already a declining trend. And the Valerie is getting worse by 2, 3 years, getting better thereafter. And a typical asthmatic is getting day by day worse over time if not treated. Therefore, I think this will almost sum up how you would treat the recurrent cough and wheeze. And every time you have a parent, draw this and tell them that at 2 years, all three of them exist. And you can't be sure which one is what. But you have an idea of which one very likely a given child is. And how would you know that? By a follow-up and a trend. And what a trend. I tell the parents to document on paper every episode in terms of frequency, duration, and a severity. And all three are getting better day by day. Not all three get better suddenly, but one of them starts getting a little better. You say probably is getting better. And you see over time a frequency, duration, severity getting better. You know that he's getting better by himself. And I think that's the way you would really go by. And a similar thing that happens further when they come in a respiratory distress. And again, if you follow simply the rule, look at this retraction, the sound, the cough, the fever, and the sign. And you will almost make a diagnosis of a respiratory distress of all kinds. For example, if it's a pneumonia, you have an intercostal retraction. Make a note, even if in a chest retraction, what part of the chest is retracting. If these lungs are compliant, then the whole intercostal retraction is evident. And therefore he has an intercostal retraction, of course he has a grunt. Every time he breathes, he says, He's grunting. Diagnosis of pneumonia is just clear. Of course, further supported by a cough, which is not so severe, but the fever is predominant and the signs are all localized. You get into an asthma, you have a subcostal, not now intercostal. Now further you have atelectatic segments, he will also intercostal retract. But basically a subcostal, and why? Because he has to force his exhalation, and therefore he has to use diaphragms a great deal to push the air out in spite of obstruction. So he is subcostally retracting. So one who retracts subcostally has an exhalation obstruction. One who is intercostally retracting has a compliant solid lung. And then, of course, he has a cough, which is a major thing, and he has no fever. And if it's a bronchiolitis, then he's just breathing fast, even 80 times a minute. He has no time to retract at all. He has no retraction, nor he has any sound. His fever cough may be yes, no, and his signs are, of course, generalized on an emphysema. And then, of course, a crupa suprasternal, inspiratory obstruction, and then, of course, a stridor. What about congenital heart disease? It's like a pulmonary edema, so they intercostally retract again, but they may not have any sound. Their cough may be minor. Of course, you have a severe sign. What about metabolic acidosis? They are just deep and rapid respiration. The chest is very clear. And what about a paralytic child? A paralytic child has low voice or no voice. Every child who has a respiratory distress is crying, trying to make his breathing better and trying to improve oxygenation by crying. Whereas this child cannot even put out voice at all. He's hypophonic or aphonic, and therefore he would be easy to pick up. I think when you have a respiratory distress, therefore you have no problem of making a diagnosis by simple thing. We will apply these rules to now actual cases and see how easy is a diagnosis of cough. This 2-year-old present with fever and cough for 6 days. Every time ask these points. If you just make these points every time in a cough, you ask what's the predominant symptom. The mother says cough. I'm not worried about fever, but sir, he's coughing badly, all right. What's the sequence of symptoms? He started with a cough and on day 3 he got fever. All infections start with fever. This child did not start with infection. What about past history? Oh, he has been always coughing, but doctor not so severely. They will not come out with the past history unless you ask them, because earlier the cough was not so severe. I think January, if I mistake not, last year, an article by Dr. Piyush Gupta, our own editor, has an excellent documentation of a very high sensitivity and specificity of a single question asked to every child who comes with a cough. What about the past history of cough? If he says, yes, my child also has had more frequent coughs than the general population, it is a hyperreactive airway, nothing else. Don't waste time in a man-to test and a chest x-ray. A highly sensitive and specific question, simple. When a child comes to you with coughing, say, has this been a first time or he always gets cough? Invariably they would say, oh, it was not so severe, so we never bothered. Fine, mild or severe is not an issue. But did he have little more often cough? Yes. That's, I think, very clear. That's a past history. Family history of atopy. Yes. Intensity of fever, mild. Imagine allergy also is an inflammation. When you get urticaria, skin is warm. When you get an asthma, there could be a mild rise in body temperature perceived by parent, and they come out with fever. Moment you have fever in mind, you say infection. Look at the sequence. Day 1 cough, day 3 fever. It's not infection. And there is very little reason to worry about the secondary bacterial infection. Asthmatics don't get into that for all practical purposes. Therefore, this is typically an hyperreactive airway disease, and you don't need tests. The point is that if you get a chest x-ray, you are in trouble, because the radiologist will point out some shadows. They will be there. What does the radiologist know? He's talking about shadows, not the disease. He does not know diagnosis. That's why I hope there's no radiologist. So he doesn't know diagnosis. In fact, he's not supposed to know diagnosis. He's supposed to describe the image. And if I show you through a window pane at a long distance an image, and if I make a human being kneel on four, my radiologist friend will say, it's a dog. Because his textbook says one who has four limbs is a dog. And if I get a dog stand on two, he will call a human being. Understand his limitations. And you want him to say whether it's a thief or a gentleman, disease or not disease, he is not the one. Of course, unfortunately, he doesn't know anything at all of the history. When did you last write a history and a suspect clinical diagnosis for a radiologist to look for? You just say, go and take a chest x-ray. Then he believes that you are a good clinician, there must be something abnormal, so he makes a normal look like abnormal. Tremendous belief on a clinician, least knowing that clinicians don't believe on themselves. So I think this child doesn't need any tests at all. This was a 2-year-old child, again same, fever, cold, cough. But this predominant fever, okay, considered viral URTI, because it started with fever, cold and cough. Again, be sure what cold and cough is. The cold and cough terminologies go together. You ask the mother, does cold means running nose? She says no. Then is it blocked nose? She says no. Then what? She says no, cough, cough. So cold is a term that is used by everyone. And it's a cold and cough is one term only. Even cough, it may not be cough at all. You say, what is cough? No. Then what? Oh, noisy breathing. So cough is called anything. Sometimes he vomits, no? He vomits mucus of her stomach. She will say, a lot of cough comes. So you say, okay, cough syrup. Lot of cough comes. So I think be sure about the terminology. And this is very simple. So this was viral URTI. Fever continued, repeat examination on day 4. We said most of the viral infection get better by day 4. This child did not. So I said, no, something is going wrong. And then follicles on tonsil. Okay, then I said, why cold? Tonsillitis doesn't have running nose. Then I realized that cold was never there at all. Because I never asked the mother, what is cold? She thinks that is cold. And I think this was finally an acute bacterial infection. Did I do wrong? No. I did a rational practice. By delaying the correct diagnosis, I did still a rational practice, because on day 1, day 2, day 3, I did not know it was tonsillitis. What does this mean? Many diseases evolve over time. You are not able to diagnose them, but you are supposed to be sure that waiting is safe. And if waiting is not safe, you can send laboratory tests and give an antibiotic. So this was very clearly the way. Look at this child, fever, cough for 6 days. Now she says, predominant symptom, both. Sometimes both are important for the mother. Past history, present. Family history, also atopy. Past history of fever, each time treated with an antibiotic. So this looked like whether it's a bacterial infection, but we know that bacterial infection rarely cough badly. To that extent, further we go by, and then we find out that this child is probably getting a repeated sinusitis or an adenoiditis, but the basic pathology is an allergy, and there is a history of atopy, family, personal, etc. So this child would need an antibiotic, but second time he comes again, when I use an antibiotic second time, I say there has to be a background cause. A background cause could be simply an allergic rhinosinusitis. This was a child again with fever, cough for 6 days, predominant symptom fever. No cold, no nasal symptom. What was the sequence? Fever came, thereafter a mild cough. Obviously, this is a pneumonia story. And then the next one. This was a 2-year-old who present with fever and cough for 6 days. When I asked the mother, what is the predominant symptom? She said, none. Both are mild. What about the past history? Fever and cough off and on for last 15 days. What was the progress like? Fever and cough continued. Chest X-ray was pneumonia. Failed 2 sets of antibiotics over the next 2 weeks. Symptoms continue. CT scan done. Pneumonia. Bowel done negative. What was this? Use the adjectives and say, this is chronic, slowly progressive, infective, pneumonia. Every statement is clear by that. It's chronic, it's progressing, it's obviously a pneumonia clinically, and therefore, even if it looked like an acute onset disease, this was very much typical. We know that TB can come anyway, acute onset as well. And what is acute onset? The small illness is missed. And to that extent, the message on this is, if a first antibiotic chosen rightly has failed, be very careful to push a second antibiotic. And if second antibiotic has failed, you have failed, not antibiotic has failed. Diagnosis has to change. What about CT scan? Tremendously overrated. You rarely need a CT scan in pediatric pulmonology. You can take a lateral, you can take any other views, okay, but not a CT scan, and therefore, and a ball further. Yes, TB might be work, but not for other situation. And this morning, Bharat talked about how a pneumococcal pneumonia really cannot be easily diagnosed. Pneumonia can be diagnosed, but pneumonia not, and not necessary for our routine purpose. This was the 2-year-old fever cough 6 days. Okay, predominant symptom both again, no nasal symptom. So you are getting into that. Now this child's growth has failed. Therefore again a request and a plea that a pediatrician is concerned with a growing phase of the human being. And the minimum that you must do is a growth chart. Minimum. And I'm ashamed to say that 99% of pediatricians do not have a growth chart. Over the last few years we have improved. Because now 10% have growth chart, but they don't plot it. So we have not even And I see this regularly. I'm sure Coimbatore or Tamil Nadu should not be an exception at all. And we say we are measuring growth. So that's important. If this child failure to thrive is picked up, you pick up a cystic fibrosis straight off, and that's how it is. This was another one, fever cough 6 days. Predominant cough. Past history, none. Family history, present. And any noisy breathing, none. We know it's an airway disease. Cough is predominant, so it's not infective or maybe a kind of infection which does not cause much fever. But there's a family history, so this becomes a pertussis. This was another one, acute onset. We are all aware that you ask for a history of onset and there's an acute onset, sudden cough, you know that it's an inhaled foreign body. A mere history. And then the last case. This was a child who 6 months is coughing. Because he's coughing 6 months, he has time to go to many of us. And each one of us adds another investigation. No, repeat at least one. He had X-rays, CT scan, but nobody had asked him the history at all. Okay. He had inhalers also, ATP, anti-TB treatment. Simple question, cough predominant, how does it upset his health? No way. When he coughs, not in sleep, not when he's playing, he's coughing when you are there. It's a habit cough. And the point that I'm making is that so many times, detailed history analysis to define microanatomy and pathology, focus physical examination to support diagnosis, then relevant minimum investigation to confirm diagnosis. And I think that alone leads to a rational therapy. So we diagnose viral infection, bacterial, recurrent, tonsillitis, pneumonia, asthma, cystic fibrosis, habit cough, inhaled foreign body. Which one we have not diagnosed by history? All of them. Now, just now we heard Dr. Lakshmi Badiran did. He did like this. Okay, that means we do that kind of examination. A quick, we have to use a stethoscope. We can't forget putting into the ear, because it's not a movie where a doctor is shown hanging a stethoscope and examining. Okay. And then you don't want to know anything, and you just want. But even a history clearly tells you that. I think this is the way the cough needs to be analyzed. What did we do? Clinical examination? Hardly any. Chest X-ray? Probably not. CBC? Useless. Okay, what did we do then? And a cough syrup, not necessary. And diagnosis is there on history only. And the whole problem is we have no time to get at history at all. I think I'll just continue in the same